we'll try to go for that. I'm going to make a couple of announcements before I introduce our panel. Next week, Thursday, IAS Thursdays, will be back downstairs on the second floor in the Crosby Seminar Room. And our speaker, which is a co-sponsored event with the Winton Chair, is Beryl Satter. And she'll be talking about From Contract Sellers to Countrywide Lessons from Analyzing Structural Racism and Resistance from the 1950s to the Present. So talking about the housing and mortgage industry and structural racism. So I hope we'll see you next Thursday downstairs, 3:30 in the Crosby Seminar Room. Many of you in this room do not need this information, but some of you might. The IAS Residential Faculty Fellowships for next year, they are the applications are due at noon on October 24th. The noon is so that if you have any problems with the university's ever-friendly workflow gen system, Susanna Smith will be available to help troubleshoot them, so you need not panic. Okay. So today's panel is a partnership with Northrop, because we're both residents in this building, and Northrop, as most of you are aware, sponsors a dance series every year. And the program today is in conjunction with the Royal Winnipeg Ballet's performance next Thursday, October 20th, of Dracula. And our panelists today are, I'll just introduce them briefly. Margaret Werry on this end, who is an associate professor of theater, arts, and dance. And her past work has been on the politics of public culture and tourism in the South Pacific. But now she's working on something that is more related to the undead, staging human remains. And I particularly like this part, can the dead perform? Joanie Smith is also in theater, arts, and dance. She's the Barbara Barker Endowed Chair and John Black Johnston Professor. She's also the artistic director of the Shapiro and Smith Dance. And this company has been going for 30 years. This is their 30th anniversary, 18 in New York and 12 here in the Twin Cities. And they spend half their time in New York and half their time here. And they perform annually at the Kohl's Center, the downtown, and also elsewhere in the world. They've toured the world several times. And among other things, they've created works on companies like the Alvin Ailey American Dance Theater and Pact Company of South Africa. Joanie's a choreographer, and she brings special relevant experience to our program today because she's also part of the honors experience on Dracula, which is an ongoing 13-week experience. And last but not least, Juliet Burba, sitting on this end, is a graduate of the PhD program in History of Science and Technology here at the University of Minnesota. She's also the chief curator of exhibits and collections at the Bakken Museum, and is currently one of the PIs on a large multi-institutional project that is using the Frankenstein metaphor to engage the public on issues of science and technology. It's a big NSF-funded grant. Her past work includes the race exhibit that was at the Science Museum of Minnesota and traveled around the country, sponsored by the American Anthropological Association. And her next exhibit is probably going to be about medical technology. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to our panel.
Thank you. So when we met to discuss this panel, we settled on a core question as our focus. How does a novel make it to the stage? But under that question lurked another. Why this novel in particular? Why is Dracula so enduring, so incessantly adapted, staged, filmed? And why does this book, a shilling shocker, already a cliché in its own time, why does Dracula still speak to us? So in this talk, I'm going to give two answers to those questions. The first draws from a now very established critical tradition that traces Dracula's 20th century prowlings through stage and screen, and that attributes his immortality to the adaptability of the archetypes that he embodies, seemingly archaic but firmly indexed to the evolving anxieties of Western modernity. The second answer I'm going to give addresses his less discussed 19th century theatrical genesis. This is less a story or the legend of a singular monster, and more a story about theatre's own afterlife, its capacity to live on through mixing its lifeblood with that of new technologies and new concerns. So let me start with story one. For a guy who kills in erotic embrace, Dracula is prodigiously fertile. The novel deals in archetypal motifs that, like the pieces of the plot itself, have been recombined through countless adaptations, like shards in a murky Gothic kaleidoscope. These motifs are sex, blood, and death, of course, but also all that their combination portends. Spectral aliens that threaten to penetrate bodily and social boundaries, contagion and invasion, racial and sexual mixing, the clash of secular modernity and ancient superstition, the perversion of kinship and reproductive futurity by Eros and Thanatos, all of which Stoker figures through an enduringly legible cluster of signs, desolate, shadowy castles, febrile virgins swooning in white lawn, pliant white throats, crucifixes, cobwebs, coffins, and capes. For a generation of critics, it is this DNA that enabled Dracula to populate entertainment culture for over a century. As Nina Auerbach famously argued in Our Vampires Ourselves, every age embraces the vampire it needs. We spawn our own undead as critique and wish fulfillment of our own modernity. So to tell the story, we might begin with Bram Stoker's wildly prolific pen, which in a manner almost akin to automatic writing, gave us a narrative that seemed to symptomatically manifest every paranoid repression of the British fantasy eclipse psyche. A psyche obsessed with the atavistic monstrosity lurking under the veneer of imperial civilization, waiting to bite back. Stoker was immersed in a London preoccupied by Jack the Ripper, Oscar Wilde, castrating new women, there's one of them, an innovated effeminate man, a London terrified of its new immigrant hordes, among them Eastern Europeans, its deviants, its sodomites and its prostitutes, and even its daughters. Stoker's novel spoke to a Britain that saw its borders and its orders, its very vitality, under sinister and invisible assault. This story, this origin story, would make a pit stop. Would make a pit stop at Nosferatu, the first film adaptation in 1922, a stark and striking vision of post-World War I German expressionism that, in its uncompromising anti-realist turn away from the world, seemed to return us to the monster as a pure emanation of an evil psyche that had both folkloric roots and a kind of perverse futurism. We could go on to Hamilton Dean and John Balderston's 1927 stage play, which placed the monster firmly among us. They traded the gloomy castle and stark mountains for a claustrophobic drawing room, Stoker's repulsive beast for a suave count in evening dress and opera cloak, played there by Raymond Hoadley, and his new woman Mina for a milksop maiden. He gave us a middle-brow mystery of manners peppered with bosom-heaving thrills that after a few years of Broadway and touring success became a staple of college seasons and community theatres and left its mark on nearly all subsequent adaptations. Still, very much in repertory today.
We might go on to Todd Browning's uneven but enduring 1931 film, which seemed to at once herald the cathartic death gasp of the decadent 20s and the looming threat of the Depression. And despite the borrowings from the play of Dean and Baldiston's play, somehow managed to reanimate the homoeroticism that the play had suppressed. From it. He sort of liberally borrowed both from the stage play and from Nosferatu, which is sort of two weird posts in an enormously sort of disjointed film. We then perhaps turn to the kitschy cheer of the 1950s Hammer films, with their vibrant, sleek, spiffy, almost suburban mise-en-scene that banished the tale's shadows along with its metaphysics, and replace them with a laser-like focus on female sexuality. Women opening windows beyond the family and in the guise of vampire victims surging into themselves and then being violently contained. It was an obsessively repeated plot in the Hammer films. I'll go on to do some sort of brief highlights. 1970s Broadway revival of the play, and a later and unabashedly feminist film with Frank LaGella, who sort of returned to the Byronic ideal of vampirism as a kind of romance. There was Gary Oldman and Winona Ryder and Francis Ford Coppola's soupy Bram Stoker's Dracula in 1932. And a whole slate of postmodern parodies amid these earnest revivals, like the Vampire Lesbians of Sodom, which ran off-Broadway for well over a decade. And then we might end this tale with the teens of our current vampire renaissance, no longer outsiders or even outsiders within, but heroes of an alienation shared with mortals, usually very cute ones. These vampires are ambassadors of a peculiarly bloodless sexuality, premised still on a kind of latent violence. Vampires are us in the social media age. So that's the first story, the story of archetypes and their adaptation. This is another. Dracula, I would suggest, is first and foremost a creature of the theatrical imagination. We might ask not how does a novel make it to the stage, but how does the stage make it to a novel and beyond, to film, to social media? Theatre is a medium premised on traffic with the dead. Night after night, actors resurrect figures from the past, transfusing their charisma into new bodies, lending them a kind of immortality. The presence on the of the dead is one of the things that gives theatre its texture, its trenchancy as a site of cultural memory. It's not only fitting then, but perhaps inevitable, that the figures that so powerfully mark the continuity of theatre are the undead. And here I'm thinking not only of Dracula, but also of Frankenstein, which my co-panelist will be addressing later. The first stage vampire in English theatre was the child of John Polidori, whose novella, The Vampire, penned in the same house as Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, a story that Juliet will cover later, was adapted first by Charles Nodier in Paris, and then in English by James Robinson Planchet, both in 1820, so less than a year after its publication. Like its undead twin, Frankenstein, which was adapted no fewer than seven times across the continent in the decade following its publication, almost simultaneously with this Dracula story. It was an instant success. The two eponymous roles even shared the same famous interpreter in the 1820s, a very famous physical and character actor called T.P. Cook. From then on, and this actually is Frankenstein, not Dracula, and you can see how the sort of Byronic figure united both monsters in those early iterations. You know, just these figures of sort of very powerful masculinity that is also profoundly eroticized.
From then on, the 19th century stage was positively lousy with vampires. Dion Boucicault and Alexander Dumas both had major successes with vampire dramas in the mid-century, and fueled by literary contributions like Joseph Sheridan Fanu's Camilla or James Reimer's Vanni the Vampire. The vampire vogue even spawned operas, which would have included ballet sequences, interestingly, by Heinrich Marschner, and still in performance today. That interestingly was first produced at the Lyceum, where Stoker would later work. Already cliched by mid-century, these monsters were firmly established within a genre, Gothic melodrama. According to Peter Brooks, melodrama enacted the ritual discovery of moral certitude in a post-sacred era. It took hold in a Europe shaken by the Industrial and French Revolutions, and flourished in the social and political turmoil of the late 19th century, of the long 19th century. It staged the battle of villainy and virtue, protest against tyranny, torture, and triumph. It offered wrenching catharsis and violent thrills in a theatrical idiom premised not on reason and judgment, but on the visceral rush of spectacle, sensation, and emotion. Melodrama, its theorists argue, was not so much a genre as a pervasive mode that reached beyond the stage to inflect the domain of expressive culture at large. And despite its nostalgic resort to folklore, noble pasts, and stories of the supernatural with which melodrama was completely obsessed, melodrama was supremely modern. Melodramatists were at the cutting edge of stage technology, experimenting with projections, disappearing tricks like the famous vampire trap invented for the first staging of Planchet's drama, conflagrations, and the dramatic possibilities of new technologies of lighting. Henry Irving, the late 19th century colossus of British theatre and Stoker's employer, Stoker's idol, Stoker's bane, at London's Lyceum Theatre, was forged as an actor in the crucible of melodrama. Even though melodrama was a popular medium and Irving claimed a much more elevated pedigree, such was the dominance of the melodramatic mode that it shaped even the classical repertory that he starred in at the Lyceum. Here he is as Mephistopheles. This is an image that dons the covers of many editions of Dracula now. This is from the first drama, sorry. This is his Macbeth. It's an artist's rendition of his Macbeth. And you can sort of see some of the echoes of the iconography of Dracula there. Most origin stories for Dracula have Stoker conducting literary and historical research to create his monster, inspired by by Irving's hauteur in these roles for his characterization of the Count. But this origin, I think, is misleading. Dracula was a genre piece taken from the stage and destined for it. Even in the language of the novel, it occasionally reads almost like stage directions. You can see the scenic art of these earlier melodramas, the gestural tableau of Gothic melodrama. Stoker staged a reading of a flung-together play script based on the novel days before its publication to secure theatrical copyright of the property. Irving sneered at it, but Stoker probably got the last laugh, if only from beyond the grave. So I could tell a much longer story about the relationship, the very close symbiotic relationship between melodrama and film, of everything that film owes melodrama, both its attention to spectacle, its narrative structures, its moral logic, particularly in early film. And I could talk about the sort of coincidence between Dracula and the moments of popularization of film itself, where film was sort of seen as this peculiarly undead medium. The filmic figures of humans were sort of understood as being these peculiar emanations from beyond the grave, the moving dead. But that's a much longer story and very well told by other scholars. But to think about it in terms of this, of the ballet that's going to be staged at Northrop. So in the light of this history, the second story about Dracula, staging Dracula as a ballet is not so much a translation as of the novel, but a return to Dracula's origins. Ballet is a living archive of the 19th century stage and its melodramatic properties. Workhorses such as Swan Lake or Giselle or La Sylphide or even Sleeping Beauty date from the heyday of Gothic melodrama. And with their interest in the supernatural, with the Gothic mise-en-scene, and their traffic in these transfixing ethereal figures of femininity that traverse the numinous territory between life and death, and the dialogue between male power and female pliancy. It seems that Dracula has not so much been translated into this medium as refound it. So that's my thoughts. And now to turn over to a ballet expert, but you were a violet, so.
No ballet expert here. Margaret, that was great. Thank you so much. I'm a modern and a contemporary dancer. A modern dance and contemporary dance is a form that flourished certainly in the United States in the 20th century and continues to flourish. I could not find many Draculas in my art form. I had to go to ballet. So I went to YouTube and Vimeo, however that's said, and I found probably 50 productions of Dracula, just going through about three pages. Interestingly enough, most of them were scheduled to be performed at this time of the year because it's around Halloween. Ballet Memphis, trick or treat, come be terrified by Dracula, you know, all of this. So the marketing, it's not something you see in the spring, you see it in the fall. And I thought about this, and I found this quote that I thought was particularly perfect. This is Clive Leatherdale. He says in his introduction to Elizabeth Miller's book, Dracula, Sense and Nonsense, he simply says, Dracula sells. And I think that sums it up. So I looked at these ballets and I said, what do they have in common? Because there were common threads. And the sets were lavish, very lavish. Even as you saw in Margaret's photograph of the Lugosi film, they're similar. I mean, they're of course made out of canvas and things that are very portable for the stage, but they have that same Gothic epic nature to them. There's a lot of wonderful stage effects. They almost have fog machines back because there's fog in almost every production I saw. Ground fog is something you get on stage. Traditionally, it's a machine or a gizmo that combines dry ice and water, if you've ever seen that combined, to make a fog. But there's some sort of, and correct me if I'm wrong over here, I'm just making this up a little bit. I've danced in these machines a lot, but I haven't taken one apart. But there's some sort of fan that pumps out this stuff, so you get a white fog. It's not bad to dance in to breathe because it's basically water-based, but it's a little frightening to dance in because you can't see the floor. And you can imagine you're dancing like this, you're not really sure when you put your foot down exactly where it is. So we have a clip of the ballet that's coming up next week, and I am impressed that they are dancing in quite a bit of ground fog. The other thing that they had in common was that Dracula is usually a very attractive aristocratic count. Dead sexy, absolutely gorgeous. The women, Lucy and Minna, are seemingly frail ballerinas. These are athletes, but seemingly frail ballerinas, played with gauzy dresses, and they are in pointe shoes. Pointe shoes are those extraordinary shoes that look like this that ballerinas dance in. They became, I would say the pointe shoe that we now see probably became, began in the mid-19th century. What happened is ballerinas on these pointe shoes were able to float across the stage, plus they had a movement in their knees, excuse me for lifting. They had a movement in their knees were bent like this, and this is a bourée, it's called a run. They're on pointe shoes, so when they do this, it doesn't look so good in combat boots, but when they do it in pointe shoes, they across the floor and they seem to glide. As Margaret mentioned, the ballets at that time, La Sylphie, Giselle, Swan Lake, everybody was a willy and a sylph and a spirit, so this was a great advantage. Pink tights, pink satin pointe shoes, and I have brought some pointe shoes.
So, I cornered a ballerina. I caught one.
Because you can't run fast in pointe shoes?
Not so much. And I got a couple of pointe shoes. She is, let me just use one for now. She is a size 7 shoe. I'm going to put it on in a minute, though I'm not excited about that particularly. The shoe has a leather back. It has something called a shank inside. This particular ballerina cuts hers in half because she only wants support for this part of her foot, not the entire foot, because she wants more flexibility here. This is called the box or the platform. This is the vamp. And these ribbons are not decorative. They actually hold the shoe on and stabilize the ankle. I was astounded speaking with her at what goes on in these things. They cost, a pair of them cost, these are custom made for the ballerina who wears them. These cost $70 to $100 a pair. And a ballerina will usually go through one pair of shoes in a performance. So you can imagine what the budget for the Royal Winnipeg Ballet toe shoe budget is. I think I counted 18 dancers. I'm guessing 12 are women because there's a core. So I bet they're performing 3 times a week. We can do the math. So 12 women times 3 pairs of shoes, let's say $100, 12 times 300, that's the weekly budget for this touring show. So it is an extraordinary undertaking. The ribbons are sewn on by the ballerina. That is absolutely tradition. I don't believe anyone else sews their ribbons on. And they're strategically placed exactly where the ballerina needs them. There's also this elastic that helps hold the foot. All right, here we go, guys. I better get something I can hold on to. I haven't had one of these on for about 30 years. So we'll see. I'm the same size. So we'll see what we can do here. She says that she has very long toes. She has very long toes, and so the vamp is very long. So first, the foot goes into the elastic. Then the ribbons, and I'm just going to do this quickly, probably not very expertly, are tied around, and then there's a knot made. I'm just going to tuck it a little bit here. She says that the knot must be tucked under and not be visible, and that if the knot or the ribbons are visible on stage, the ballerinas are fined $25 by the union. Okay, I can't do this without help. So that's what it looks like. In this shoe, she stuffs paper towels. because she says they absorb the sweat. It makes the shoe last a little bit longer. Interestingly enough, she talked a lot about, she's 50 now, she talked a lot about, say, 20 years ago when she was dancing professionally in New York. They all wore pink tights, and so of course the shoe is pink satin, but she is a woman of color. And she found this very odd, as did many of the people she was dancing with, that they were wearing pink tights. And so I'll show you another pair of shoes where she's changed the color of them, and that's very common now that shoes come in pink satin, but also in various shades of flesh. So I'm not gonna stand up, but I don't think I can. But that's what it looks like. All right. Oh, it even hurts just walking it. Other things that ballerinas do, they stuff it with lamb's wool. There are rubber toe spacers you can use so that your toenails don't get destroyed. You literally are dancing like this on the top of the toes. For her, she said she actually dances over the toes, and so she's on dancing on the toenail. All right. These are athletes, I have to stress again. This is not easy stuff. What she explained to me, though, that's very interesting, she said that she doesn't regard the toe shoe as a torturous thing, that the physics of it, she said, are brilliant, because what happens is you become one long line from the hip, through the thigh, through the knee, through the ankle, and then up on the toe. So it's very straight line. As a contemporary dancer, I would dance in releve, which looks like this. Can you, I don't know if you can see. It looks like this. It's not going to be a straight line. So there's no way, even if I could turn five times around, that I might be able to achieve that, because it's just not the same physics. If I'm up here, though, and it's a straight line, it's a definite advantage. All right, enough about point shoes, but I thought you might be interested. That brings us to the Dracula we're going to see next week, I hope. I hear that it's selling very well, so if you want to see it, you better grab tickets soon. It's choreographed by Mark Godden. And 1998 was the original choreography, I believe, on the Royal Winnipeg. He's done it on a number of companies, and we have a clip of him with North Carolina Dance Theater. Melodrama, definitely. Mark Godden's Dracula is to Mahler. Different symphonies, parts of symphonies. I am essentially talking about a piece I've not seen right now, because I've not seen it yet. But we have a film, and I've seen clips of it. And so I want to show you, if we can, a little bit. Let's do the film one first, the one with all the music. You just put it up, we'll see which one it is. Yeah, the black and white film. So this is Guy Madden's film. This is about a minute and a half. From 2001, and it's a film of Mark Godden's Dracula. It's a film of the Royal Winnipeg performing it. It's very much a melodrama. Oh, that fog. Let's show the next clip. This is Mark Godden, the choreographer, speaking, and this is, he's with North Carolina Dance Theater, and you'll get a little sense of him. It's also nice to see what the dance looks like behind the scenes. They're in rehearsal clothes, they're just in a studio, but they're on point, and they're in some facsimile of the costume, so that they can get, the women have, you know, something like this on, so they can wave it around and figure out how they're going to deal with their costume.
My name is Mark Godden. I'm the choreographer for Dracula, to be premiered with North Carolina Dance Theater. And like any good drama, I guess the whole thing is about sex, death, and money. Lucy Gilchrist. She'll be performing the role of Lucy Westenra. She's a phenomenal dancer. She's got an incredible emotional range. The other person that's unique to me in the production is Alessandra. Alessandra Ball's new to the role of Mina Murray.
The role of Mina takes place mainly in Dracula's castle, and it should be really interesting. The set should be really fun and very elaborate.
All right. No, don't get those tickets. That was about 5 years ago. I do have a review. I could not find out what newspaper this was from. It's written by Kaya Pepper. I know she's a writer now in Canada. And here's what she says. And this is interesting. This touches a little bit on what Margaret said about the women. The two women in this story, Lucy and Minna, are very different. Lucy is more a traditional Victorian woman who more of a victim of what happens. Minna is a bit of the modern woman and reveals her passion with her fiancé. She says, Godden creates a Dracula that is a gentleman and dead sexy, an elusive, shadowy force upon which the heroines can satisfy erotic longings, stilted elsewhere, and with whom they can dance in a way they cannot with their straight-laced Victorian men. In the final scene, however, Godden puts Dracula's cruelty center stage, and a choice becomes necessary as evil is now set clearly before us. Naturally, we're glad Minna, Godden's strong 20th century woman, renounces Dracula and saves the good men. The question, though, remains, who will dance with Minna and go with her to those dark, passionate places? Thank you.
That I know best, which is Frankenstein's monster. I see my font didn't come through. So the font's going to look funny. I had a different font on here. I hope that you'll be able to read this. So I, as Jennifer mentioned, I'm from the Bakken Museum. I'm a curator there. And I've been working on an exhibit about Mary Shelley. And we've also had this long-standing relationship with Frankenstein at that museum. We have an object theater there about the story, Frankenstein's story. But now we're exploring Mary Shelley's story. So as a part of that work, I've been thinking a lot about how to take this monster, this 200-year-old monster, and translate it into something that's relevant to today's audiences, and in the case of a museum audience, Most often that's a family and even a teenager audience, so I guess in some ways maybe the twilight is relevant to us. So in the course of this work, I've been also thinking a lot about what is it that makes this story endure. As we know, Frankenstein is everywhere. This is a story that's really lasted. This is an image that's lasted. And what is it that makes this story last? And I've got some images. Oh, I just wanted to mention, too, before I move on. So the exhibit's opening. I'm going to just put a little plug in for the exhibit and for the preview party, which is coming up on the 27th. So if you have nothing to do on October 27th, which is a Thursday evening, come down to the Bakken for a sneak peek at the exhibit. So I collected some images here, and this is a variety of images of Frankenstein. This is from the first performance of Frankenstein that was just years after Mary Shelley published her novel. But as we know, it's really lasted. This is from Edison's first movie, 1910. And then we've got, of course, everyone's familiar with this one. I was a teenage Frankenstein from the 50s. Some of you might know Scooby-Doo. That's my first Frankenstein memory. This is a favorite. Frankenberry, the Munsters, and of course a recent play that's really great. So if you ever have a chance to see that, I recommend it. And then the most recent from Penny Dreadful. Some of you might recognize that. I think it's a really interesting interpretation of Frankenstein. So those are just some of the images. I want to step back and talk a little bit about the origin of this story. And as Margaret mentioned, there is a common origin. It's certainly not the only origin for Bram Stoker's story, but it's at least maybe kind of the starting point. Vampires had existed before that in various forms, but John Polidori is the one who was credited with creating a kind of suave vampire. So I'm just going to tell briefly, some of you might know this story. It goes back to 1816 when Percy Shelley, and her stepsister Claire went to visit Lord Byron in Geneva, and his personal physician, John Polidori, was there. It was a terrible summer. There had been a volcanic eruption. Tambora had destroyed weather around the world. Very cold, very rainy. They spent a lot of time inside. And one evening, Byron said, "Let's all come up with a ghost story." And out of that came Frankenstein. Mary Shelley started it that summer. Polidori took a fragment that Byron had written, and that became the vampire, and many say that it was modeled on Byron. So Mary Shelley, this is often labeled the first work of science fiction. I think that's, you could argue against that, but it certainly is a very early work that some describe as science, and Mary Shelley was certainly influenced by the science of her time. This was really a heyday for science as public culture, and Mary would have likely attended lectures. Actually, she recorded attending at least one lecture in her diary on science. She would have overheard discussions or maybe even participated in discussions in her home. So she was exposed to the science of her time. And so one of the obvious places to look at for influences is the work that was being done in the late 18th and early 19th centuries, exploring the relationship between electricity and the body. At that time, there was an intense debate that arose between two Italian researchers, Alessandro Volta and Luigi Galvani, about the nature of this electricity, about the nature of the effects of electricity on the body. I won't go into the detail of what they were debating, but this work, the work that they were doing, originally they're conducting it using frog legs, as you can see here. Out of this work, Alessandro Volta invented the battery. So this was the first source of a steady electricity that you could use to experiment with. And so with that source of electricity, they graduated to experimenting on larger animals that would require more of a charge. So here you can see experiments taking place with bulls' heads, and those tall things that you see, those are the batteries. Those are the voltaic piles that they were using to electrify and show the effects. And then from there, they graduated to doing it on corpses. And I decided to include this. I know it's really gruesome, but I thought in keeping with the sort of Halloween theme, we would have this. We would include this. So this kind of work, and of course this wasn't a common thing. It wasn't all that easy to get cadavers to do this kind of work. And Aldini, whose work this comes from, had come to London and got the body of an executed criminal, and there were demonstrations of this at the Royal College of Surgeons. Mary Shelley very likely didn't see anything happen with a human body, but she could have seen the kinds of things that I was showing earlier with bulls' heads and things of that sort. And just to give you an effect, so I just want to demonstrate the eerie nature of this.
Uh-oh.
And so I will need, and I know one of our volunteers has seen this, so that volunteer cannot volunteer for this. I need a volunteer who is not afraid of electricity. Will one of my co-panelists volunteer?
Shock me, darling.
So,
I do soon, by the way.
We won't do this.
They have these at the chiropractor, Margaret.
So this is a common device, and some of you, this might not be surprising. I think that will work. So this will give you a sense for the eerie nature.
Okay.
So now you tell me when you feel something. Just let your hand relax. Do you feel anything?
Yeah.
You let your hand relax and just
I'm not doing that.
Try to control your hand. Well, let's see. You just tell me. So you can you stop it?
No, I cannot stop
okay.
that.
So you can imagine now.
I thought I was unshockable.
I know. You can imagine on another scale with a dead animal or a cadaver. Thank you very much. How eerie this would have been, and there are certainly terrifying descriptions of the kinds of motions that these bodies made when they were being electrified. So this is a broadside. This is the kind of demonstration that would have been happening more in the public. It would have been the kind of thing that somebody could have paid a small amount and attended, and you could see they were advertising the crawling, kicking, leaping in the detached limbs of dissected animals that they would evoke using electricity. So this is the science that really interested me, coming from a museum that specializes in electricity, and in particular in how electricity relates to the biology, medicine, and Mary Shelley had other scientific influences. A big one that factors in there is polar exploration, of course. Interestingly, she doesn't use the word electricity when she describes the birth of the monster. She only says that it was infused with the spark of being. That's her full description. But it evokes electricity, certainly. And in a later preface, she mentions galvanism. In working on this, though, so we started with the point, the science. But what I very quickly realized are all the other influences that Mary Shelley brought to this book. She had a very complicated life. She was very highly educated. And she brought a number of influences to this book. Oh, I got ahead of myself here.
at the time when she started it, she was 18 years old. She had already lost a baby, a premature baby. She had felt that her Percy had been really quite indifferent to that loss. That year, as she was working on it, that of 1816, her half-sister committed suicide, and Percy's wife committed suicide, and with the death of Percy's wife, they were able to marry. She had pressures from her father, some of the letters that she receives from him following the death of her baby are really quite cold. The novel is also a critique of romantic ideals, a critique of the kind of romantic genius, the lone genius, and instead suggests that science should be practiced in the light, not in some lab where anything can happen, and that really people need one another. It's really a plea for empathy, I think. And so these things that she brought to it, these many emotional experiences and not just intellectual experiences, it's these that became part of her monster. These things are reflected in the questions that her monster asks. And so I would say one of the things that really makes this monster endure are these questions. It's these questions that it raises, and not just questions about science. That it of course raises questions about the practice of scientific research, and this has become a powerful metaphor even today. Everyone has seen things, Frankenfoods, of course, but the metaphors continue. It also raises questions about ethical limits on science, the responsibility of scientists, not just of scientists, but responsibility of creators for their creations, parents for their children. It raises questions about empathy, about evil, about nature versus nurture, and certainly raises questions about what it means to be alive and what it means to be human. And so it's all those rich questions that make this story relevant still today. I think it's really enduring. I like to use the kaleidoscope metaphor, and I've used that in talking about this. It really is a kaleidoscope. You can spin it any way, and it's all there. You see things a little differently, but it's all there. And so my question would be, I'm sorry about this font. It just looks terrible. It looked great before. So here are my questions. So what are the questions that Dracula is asking? And I think certainly we've talked about some of them, but what are those fundamental questions that still resonate with us? And as somebody who's outside of dance and theater, the question that came to my mind is, how do you ask those through movement? How do you ask questions through movement? And so I had this to close, and you can see the Frankenstein, the eroticized male. I've heard people say this is from the 1831 edition, that he looks like Fabio.
Decapitated Fabio.
Yes. So I will close with that, and thank you.
Okay, so we have time for questions and answers, presumably, from our panelists, and I will let them field those questions, and feel free to start. Kristen.
Thank you so much for a wonderful presentation. One of the things I was wondering as I listened to you talk about the introduction of Dracula and Frankenstein in a historical sense, is wondering what that encounter would have been like for the people who, for the very first time, read or saw images of Dracula or Frankenstein. And in a way, I think that first encounter is something that at least I can't remember for myself. I mean, it's so ingrained in our culture. We see these images that are stylized and these sort of representations that are really well known to us. But I'm wondering, way back when, how did people take this new form or this new genre? And the one thing that really seems interesting to me is looking at Frankenstein, this picture and then the very first picture that you had. The first picture to me didn't look like the Frankenstein that I know. I mean, it almost looked like the statue of David. I mean, he didn't look as scary as the one that we have. And similar with yes. Dracula. Yeah. And so I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on that.
Well, to answer your first question, I mean, I think in some ways the point of my presentation is that there was never really a first time of people encountering Dracula, that when the novel was published, it was already a cliché, right? There was already such an established discourse around vampires, that, you know, the parts of the story had been told countless times before in novels and novellas, on and off the stage. Henry Irving thought that it was just an intolerable piece of pop shop, and that it was completely unworthy of his theatre. So in some ways there was nothing that was novel or shocking about it. And when it actually made it onto the stage in the late 20s, it was a parlour melodrama. Right? You know, what was the first, the Nosferatu, which was the first filmic adaptation of it, you know, it's sort of an open question how much it owes to Stoker's Dracula and how much it owes to previous iterations of the various sort of Dracula stories dating from the early 19th century onwards. But what was surprising about that was that it was avant-garde, right? That it wasn't this sort of, in this kind of gothic melodrama medium so much, but rather that it reached for a sort of novel aesthetic idiom that was quite striking to people. So, you know, in many ways, the lack of novelty is what is so interesting about these figures, that they are actually our familiars in many senses. You know, I wanted to begin my presentation with a picture that my four-year-old drew of Dracula. He's never heard the story, and he came home from daycare with this little image of this perfect, weird kind of cubist vampire. It's like, you know, so the story will never be unfamiliar to him, right? That it's so much sort of part of that fabric. And then the second question of the unfamiliarity of those early 19th century, both the Dracula and the Frankenstein figure, which manifested on stage in similar ways, that they weren't monstrous or animalistic in the same way that they became later on in the century, but rather the peak adaptation, which was the first stage adaptation of Frankenstein, he's this enormously sympathetic, very noble character, much as he is in the novel, and even in the novel you don't. The disgust towards Frankenstein is all from, towards the monster, sorry, is all from Frankenstein, his maker, right? But not, yeah, so when he gets staged, it's rather as a sort of heroic and sort of tragic figure.
And certainly people were exposed to these images of horror. There were shows, the phantasmagoria that people would attend, that were scary shows that had goblins and skeletons and things of that sort. And so they weren't new, this kind of horror. And the night before Mary Shelley began the story, they had been reading ghost stories, the phantasmagoriana. And so these images, they did come from, it was continuous. On the other hand, when Frankenstein was first published, the reviews were scathing, and it was seen as absolutely horrible. And I'm just thinking about that now. I've never thought too much about this, but I wonder if it's because of the construction from the dead. It's not a mythological or supernatural being. Mm-hmm. It's actually very natural.
Mm-hmm. And the reviews and controversies in that era about the medical use of the dead.
Yes,
the medical act that happened, what was it, 10 years after the initial publication. I mean, that was the public discourse in London during that era.
Touched a nerve that was different than thinking about the supernatural, which is what vampires would have spoke to.
And the reviews, and Matt, jump in if I miss something, but the reviews when Bram Stoker's Dracula first came out, said it was gory and erotic and shocking. And in fact, in this review of the choreography that you may see next week, two people fainted at the premiere because it was so explicit. And I have watched the whole film, which is about 1 hour and 10 minutes, which the ballet, I think, runs 2 hours and 10 minutes. So I guess I'm only seeing half. But they do a very good job of beheading Lucy. It is kind of shocking because you're sitting there seeing it live. I mean, I'm imagining myself in the theater. So, and I think that when Margaret spoke about some of the theatrical things that were available in at that time, they were incredibly sophisticated and, I mean, could just terrify you. So I think that, you know, that added a terrific element.
But the terror was also very much manufactured, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
It's like the Dean and Baldiston play from first on the London stage for a year and then for a couple of years on Broadway, they would hire a nurse to be in the audience and they would advertise this.
Yes.
And they cast the nurse very specifically. She had to be a very sensible, robust-looking nurse. She wasn't allowed to be pretty or anything like that. But, you know, that was a feature that you were actually expected to and primed to and almost sort of cued to faint.
I learned that there's going to be two women. Now, the story that I know doesn't involve but one woman. How do they fit in two? What is the story of the two women? How are they contrasted? How are they woven into the plot?
So the Lucy Mina thing, I talked about the different pieces of the Dracula plot being taken apart and put together like a jigsaw puzzle or a kaleidoscope over the 20th century. In Bram Stoker's Dracula, the original novel, there are two women, Lucy Westenra and Mina Murray. And Lucy is more of a sort of traditional Victorian lady. She's a bit of a flibbertigibbet. She gets vampirized really early. She's a white lawn chick, swoons and dies. And then is resurrected as this sort of succubus. And Mina Murray is this more sort of sensible new woman figure. She's identified with a new woman. And she is one of the team with her fiancé, Jonathan Harker, who participate in the staking of the vampire. Right? And in the various iterations over the 20th century, those roles get conflated manipulated and
Sunfield and Harker are sometimes the same person.
In many of the adaptations there is no meaner figure, this sort of stronger woman who survives. In some of them there are in the Hammer ones there are like thousands of women all with these vast pneumatic appetizing bosoms. That's one of those sort of very fungible features of the Dracula story. The women sort of get made to order depending on the kinds of arguments that the plot seems to want to make about femininity and about that the ultimately sort of erotic relationship with the vampire.
And you'll see quite a number of women in the ballet production because there is a corps de ballet, the chorus. They have to have something to do. So I believe they're going to be maids and nuns, but there'll be probably a group of about 10 women dancing that are, and I looked at the program notes, they have all, sometimes they're peasants, sometimes they're gypsies, sometimes they're nuns, sometimes they're maids, sometimes they're demons. They're various, various different things, but the two primary characters in this ballet are Lucy and Mina, which is like Stoker's novel. But as Margaret says, the way that it kind of gets shifted around, the ballet begins in Lucy's drawing room or Lucy's bedroom. The book starts in Transylvania, So I think the ballet goes off of the production you were speaking of, the 1927, mm-hmm. where it starts.
You mentioned Transylvania. My gestalt is there was some horrible character from Romania that spawned this story.
Vlad the Impaler. No.
Is that a different story from
Dracula? It's a common misunderstanding, apparently. Elizabeth Miller, this book that we've been reading, it's very interesting, Dracula, Sense and Nonsense, that apparently this was the common thought, is that Vlad the Impaler was the beginning of this story for Bram Stoker, but it apparently is not true. He took the name Dracula, but it has nothing to do other than that.
What's the story of Vlad Dracula? It's not a part of this, you know?
Matt, can you answer that?
Sure, I'm not a historian. Someone else knows the tale better than I do. Please weigh in. He was a 15th century prince, basically. He was held as a ward of the Ottoman Sultan for a while so that his father would behave and be a loyal vassal and keep Southeast Europe open to Turkish armies and trade and such. And his father was eventually betrayed and murdered by yet another vassal of the Turks. There's a lot of politics involved. And Vlad went and returned to Transylvania, Wallachia, which was the province then, and at different times held this principality for shorter or longer periods, three times in his life before he was betrayed and murdered. But he was especially famous for the bloody tortures that he wreaked on his political and military enemies, including impaling, and developed a series of historical personas after he had died, such that he was a Romanian folk hero, but he was seen as a devil or a demon in Western Europe, and then seen as a cruel but powerful model for rulership in Russia and Eastern Europe.
And Dracula means devil, yes?
Yes, or dragon.
Or dragon, right.
And it was taken, Stoker took it from another novel, right? Glenarvan? I think there was another novel.
One of the main influences was Emily Gerard, I had,
right.
Transylvanian Superstitions.
Right.
So
there is a nod to Vlad the Impaler, in the ballet, but I don't want to spoil the end for you, but there is a nod to it.
So I'm really struck here by that issue of melodrama and entertainment, of scaring people and scariness as entertainment, and also that issue of, you know, you raised the passionlessness, so to speak, of at one level of Victorian culture and particularly in expectations of women's roles. But I'm also struck, by the way in which the broadside for the electrical demonstrations are very much about, you know, spectacle and enticing the public with scary, gory spectacle, and the way in which that is also part of the Dracula story. And here we have two different animating forces. So we have this question of what does it mean to be human and what is the vital force? One is blood and one is electricity, and one is you know, maintaining the body in a sense, and one is creating a new body. And kind of I'm raising many issues here, but kind of in relation to Christopher's question too, would it have been the same people likely to see? Oh no, never mind. That's anachronistic. Never mind.
Although there were vampire plays earlier. So
the first vampire play was the one based on Polidori.
Yeah, so would it have been the same audience who would have gone to see Presumption?
Oh, yeah. I mean, they're the same actors. They probably used the same sets. They were at the same theaters. They were in the same touring repertories. I mean, you know, they would have been in many ways kind of functionally indistinguishable. I mean, you know, that's what it means to be part of a genre, right? You change the parts, but the apparatus is essentially the same. And so there, you know, there's a lot of sort of winnowing out of the sort of specificities of the tales themselves that happens in that process.
Mm-hmm. I have a short follow-up on that. You began with the motifs of sex, blood, and death. But in your film, the Godden is shown saying sex, money, and death. So I wonder if there's some reflection there in the evolution of our culture. And secondly, where does money come into this?
I had the same question, and in the film there's a whole chest of money, which I
doesn't
really
stand
sure.
for power.
Perhaps.
I mean, for ages and ages, the leaders went after the money. That's why mm-hmm. the Romans conquered all of Europe and you know went into Israel and Egypt. It's after the money.
There's there have been a lot of readings of Bram Stoker's novel that have reflected on mm-hmm. his sort of his what they see as a kind of critique of that moment of capital in England in the novel. But there's been a lot of recent work thinking about why are we in this vampire and zombie renaissance? Like, what are the undead doing in contemporary popular culture? I mean, they're absolutely ubiquitous. And one of the predominant arguments that people are making is that it's very much attached to a sort of a contemporary moment of capital, and particularly to the idea of dead labor, right? that as laboring bodies, we've essentially become expendable.
So these are Trump voters we're talking about.
We knew it'd get in your son.
So can I take advantage of, so Matt Ribitzer Stull is here, and I want to say that I think of Mahler, and you can totally re-educate me, but I think of Mahler as melodramatic, or at least dramatic music. And do you want to talk a little bit about the music for this ballet?
Sure, I'm actually going to be presenting, we're doing a non-course experience involving 7 faculty and 11 students through the honors program, and we're meeting more or less weekly throughout the semester to talk about the Dracula story and ideas of translation, how it went from a novel and then how you turned it into a film or a play or a video game or a comic or do a spin-off novel. And are there any recurring themes throughout all of these various media? And the music piece is interesting. So if you want to hear more about this, we're going to be discussing it a week from yesterday, Wednesday, in Ferguson Hall, room 123 at 4:30 p.m. Right? Okay. So I'll just say a little bit here. If you want to hear more, you can do that. I actually think the choice of Mahler is somewhat surprising because he grows out of this tradition of he's writing around the same time as German expressionists who are dealing with some of the same gothic, dark themes that we think of at Dracula tapping into a little bit earlier. But his musical cultural heritage comes largely from Wagner and from 19th century Germany, and he's often pitted against another German composer, Richard Strauss, who is his contemporary and another cultural inheritor of Wagner's, as the sort of the two ways that music went after Wagner, tonal music anyway. And Strauss, interestingly, is the one who's writing opera, who's dealing with themes of eroticism, who's doing a lot of program symphonies, so pieces of music that explicitly tell stories, Don Juan and Macbeth and Helen and many of his symphonic poems. And Mahler ends up going much more the route of, closer to absolute music. So the music that's being used for the ballet, symphonies 1 and 2, are not absolute music, they have stories. But Mahler 9, not any story that we know of. In fact, it's an incredible piece of just sort of sounding form, if you want to talk about music in that sense. And Mahler goes back much more to a Beethoven ideal of writing for instruments and then voices with instruments. So if you think of Beethoven's choral symphony, Mahler tends to like to add vocal soloists and in one case chorus to his symphonies. But he's writing in a traditional form largely. Symphonies or lieder, art songs. And so the use of it to be almost like film music, if you will, I mean, we have this stage drama of the ballet, there's human figures moving on a big stage, and then we've got music accompanying that. Mahler's not the composer I think of. I think of Wagner, I think of Strauss much more than I think of Wagner. And so I don't know the choreography at all, and I don't know the plot of the ballet, and I'm interested to see how these three totally distinct pieces, so the Titan Symphony, D major story of redemption and this dark minor mode theme that comes back in a kind of Beethoven heroic light setting at the very end of the piece. The Resurrection Symphony, the C minor symphony number 2, which is dark, has a very dark beginning. You can see Margaret Werry appeal for Dracula. And then 9, which is hard to describe with any kind of affect. I'm not sure how they're going to cut and paste the pieces together and stitch this together to tell the Dracula story. So I'm going to talk about the music before I see the ballet, which may be instructive because I won't know exactly what I'm saying on Wednesday.
Hey, I did it today.
But I hope I'll have some good questions to get the students and faculty thinking about what they're listening to and what they're watching.
I guess one more sort of technical question. So in those 50 different sort of ballet presentations, are there, you know, what's consistent and what's different? Is there different music and different choreographers for each one?
Yeah. So the music was all over the map. I did see one rock ballet, which I'm going to try to get for our group, a rock Dracula that was done in Pittsburgh, I think. But the music was all over the map. It was... some music was composed, last year for the production, and then other pieces were from the classical canon. But as I was saying before, the things that were common were spectacle, the sets and the costumes and the fog and the things coming and going and how blood was used and how you could make these wonderful effects happen of chopping someone's head off right in front of people and sort of magic. It asked for really a willing suspension of disbelief to watch that. And Dracula was gorgeous in every one. And I guess the reason that I didn't see contemporary or modern or contemporary concert dance is... I don't think that art form can afford the cost of the spectacle. That's just not, it's a very different whole set of finance. And the other thing is, I think that more contemporary art form is not so interested in telling stories, but discovering the unique gesture or the unusual vocabulary, the unusual structure.
I have a question for the panel. Do we still have time?
Yeah.
I'm interested in, so Joanie used this word spectacle, which I think is a great word, because that seems to go hand in hand with Dracula. And what I'm at least finding as we're going through all these different media representations of Dracula is that they all involve spectacle of one kind or another, whether it's erotic or violent or the spectacle of vulnerability and the human bosom and all that we see all the time. And for some reason, none of these various art forms can ever seem to rise above a good bad movie. If you know what I mean, like it's a bad movie, but you'd like to watch it. It's a good bad movie. The novel's a good bad novel. All of the movies I've seen, the best of them are good bad movies. Can you do Dracula without spectacle? Can it rise to the level of art and nuance? And if so, how? And if not, why not?
I would say no. I mean, I think that it's fundamentally a genre piece. It's fundamentally a melodrama. That's its DNA. And that, you know, spectacle is a sine qua non of melodrama. That's where, you know, that's exactly why all those 50 productions sort of looked alike, even though they were done to different music by different companies. But that their basic sort of idiom is very set now. You know, insofar as we still want our Dracula to be sexy, scary, and fill seats, and I'm quoting Joanie here, I don't think we can, that producers can afford to move away from spectacle. You know, what you do within that, of course, is a matter of artistic invention and artistic license. I mean, you can have a good bad movie, or a good bad movie, or a bad movie. You know, I think that there are many gradations and there are many interesting choices that you can make within that idiom. But I think that fundamentally, yes, spectacle is part of the equation of Dracula.
That's an interesting question. I made mention of a show that I've been watching, Penny Dreadful, in which all of these characters come together. And in that, of course, vampires are there along with Frankenstein's monster. And the parts that have the vampire are all spectacle. They're creepy, they're big, they're dramatic. And then the parts that have Frankenstein's monster are very emotional, and they're just very, very different. And so it just made me think, well, once again, in this story, the vampires occupy the spectacle. Yeah.
One last thought about the music, too. Strauss, I mentioned earlier, spectacle composer. Not all the time, but if you think of his most famous ballet, Salome, I mean, there's a beheading there. There's a lot of gore and eroticism in many of his stage works. Mahler, not a spectacle composer, much more nuanced artistry, introversion, retrospection. So again, I'm interested to see if this is a good management.
I want to put a word in for Werner Herzog's Nosferatu. Mm-hmm. Is having a little more gravitas than most of the other
films. I would have mentioned it. I haven't seen it. I feel like I would be talking out of turn in my head, but yeah. Do we have another question over here? Yes, Mary?
I had a follow-up question, and I guess you sort of answered it a little bit with your Mahler example, this question I asked purely out of curiosity as someone who works primarily on comedy and popular culture. But what's an example of a kind of nuanced artistic representation that's completely devoid of spectacle?
My conversation with Andre.
My dinner with Andre?
My dinner with Andre. Yeah. Yeah.
I guess it depends what your definition of spectacle is. No, that's fundamentally to be observed.
Yeah, if it's observed,
there's always going to be some element of aesthetic self-consciousness about it. And I think, you know, there's a certain sort of, you know, one of the melodrama and its relationship to spectacle has become a class. It has always been a discourse about class, and I think that our aversion to spectacle or our sort of sniffiness sometimes about it is very much about that, you know, sort of that fear of the sort of, you know, class trappings of medium, right? You know, we're speaking in kind of edifice of higher culture here, I guess. So I guess, you know, one of the questions might be why do we revile spectacle? Why do we fear it? Why do we feel that something of significance cannot be said within that medium?
Just to disentangle some of those class implications, I mean, on the one hand, we're sort of invoking spectacle as pandering to melodramatic sensationalism and the kind of exhibition of sexuality, but then I'm thinking of these really uncanny slides of galvanism that you showed, and this idea of electricity as the spark of life or vitality or vitalism, which seems to be a completely different iteration of sexuality, I mean, of spectacle, than the sort of lowbrow pandering to what sensational sexuality. I'm just kind of thinking about how that the uncanny undeadness and the, you know, like jazz hands spectacle double in a really sort of interesting and complex way in these dance performances of both Dracula and Frankenstein. Are there ballets in Frankenstein?
Didn't we think of one?
You found one.
Did I?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah,
I did.
Yeah,
it was a very
recent
one.
I didn't look at it. But yes,
yeah,
it was really
yeah,
recent.
Yeah. And it looked actually.
Yeah, it looked interesting.
Sort of interesting. But yes.
I do have a contemporary Dracula.
Carl Flink
did a part for an opera, but still it's for an opera. And it is, you know, it's grand. So it's still grand, it's just not in point shoes, and it's more athletic and sort of a different approach, but so I sort of kept it in the ballet spectacle room.
Well, I want to
thank our panelists for both erudition, but also the spectacle of Joanie and toe shoes, Margaret's
touching them,
inadvertent jazz hand.
That was so cool.
So, thank you all very much.